This is a book I designed. It's about how complicated the violin is to play. It's even more complicated to build. It's about the violin makers and all the skills they have in order to make a good violin. I took this picture myself and I edited it in Photoshop and used that for the cover, and I like the movement you have there and the bow going across the string and things like that. But I also, this was an experience for me in getting the right type choice, adjusting the leading so that each page that you read, it's easy on the eyes, it's easy to read. I wanted to do handwriting, but I wouldn't work, it'd be too hard on the eyes to read anyway, and you can see that each page is consistent. Anyway, there's the history of the violin. You have the Chinese violin, the cylinder-shaped object there, so it makes it resonate, and the koto, Japanese instrument, is also in the violin family, but you don't use a bow, and it's just not the same as a violin anyway. Doesn't sound as nice either. So anyway, there's been modifications of the violin from the original Chinese instrument. There's a cylinder-shaped object on the Chinese instrument that allowed resonation. You have a drone string and you have another string that you slide up and down and get different notes out of it. That's where the body of the violin originated from. And as time went on, they changed the shape of the body to have a body that resonates better. It has a nicer tone. They've also put four strings on it, as I've shown in this picture here. And so you have a lot more versatility with the violin. And now it's evolved to what we have today in this picture. This photo was taken at the Halifax Farmers Market by Lindsay Schigsworth. And from here we get into violin making and how they make the violin now. You take the two halves of the body of the violin and carve it down to a specific thickness to get the appropriate resonation. And another important thing is also the type of wood and the age of the wood and the preservation of the wood. A violin maker is a carpenter, he's an architect, he's a designer. There's a whole bunch of different crafts that go into violin making. And all of that will have an outcome in the sound of the violin. So this is a Hungarian violin maker that I've painted from photo references. This instrument here will measure the thickness of the wood in all these different parts. There's a template that's used from successful violins that have been broken down and measured and studied. So this is how you would get the thickness of different parts of the violin body using this tool. And here's the same Hungarian violin maker. He's carving the headstock and carving out the F hole in the violin. And the book goes on to talk more about the history and the history of the violin and things like that. And also there's a lot of math involved too in adjusting, setting up the violin once you make it. Everything has to be just in the right spot to get the right kind of sound. And there's another mystery that we have also about the varnish that goes in the violin. A lot of people think that the varnish will also, well, it does affect the sound, but what goes in the varnish could be another thing that gives it a sweeter or a warmer tone. So that's another mystery that people that study violins debate about. They tried to figure out what was in Stradivari's varnish, but it wasn't anything special, it was just a common thing. Anyway, there's the back of the book. I got some the grains and the varnish texture on the back there, and it talks about the history of the violin and things like that. So I put all that together, and nice little book anyway. It's got nice colors to it, nice paintings, and nice type choice. I still have to send it off to get it printed and things like that, but there we go. That's pretty much that.